How did you do with your spiritual practice today? Did you wake up and you feel like, well, I'm failing. I'm not getting anywhere. You know, there's no breakthroughs. Might as well give up. And all of that talk, right? Well, this is pretty much what happens to all of us every single day. We wake up and it's the same old world. Same old troubles. Everything is, you know, is just the same misery. And we feel like, well, we haven't made any progress, haven't gotten anywhere. Okay, this is what confronts us every morning. And so I was in that spiral, negative spiral, and then I said, hey, wait a minute. I started remembering the day before the taping I did. And I said, hey, wait a minute. I'm making tremendous progress. It's just almost unheard of progress here. What am I talking about that I'm failing? That's crazy. And so I reconnected with the wow. Now, I would say that the key to success on the spiritual path is this glass half empty, glass half full dichotomy. And it requires an effort of will on your part, on our parts, to recognize that the glass is actually half full, because we're in a wow situation where we're still stunned from the progress that we've made in the previous day. Especially if it's a lot of progress like I experienced, I'm still stunned in the wow. And so I wake up, I'm in this stunned condition still, and I think like, oh gosh, I'm just nowhere. I just look at me, I've gone backwards. Well, it's terrible. So in other words, the glass is half empty. Glass is half empty. And then I say, wait a minute. I start remembering, you know, what the video that I had done, and the taping, and the tremendous breakthroughs. And not only that, but some more breakthroughs after that. Just wow. I don't even want to say what they are. They're so tremendous. And so I said, wait a minute, my glass is half full. I'm just in the wow phase of my practice. I haven't failed. And so as soon as you tip it from glass half empty to glass half full, completely changes your outlook and you regain your confidence. And you go keep working, which I did today. And the insights keep coming. And they're very, very profound. And yet, it's possible to see the glass half empty, to look at it that way, to get pessimistic. So it does take an effort of will on your part. This is why I say that full stop in the wow, you need to recognize it. You need to recognize that you have to manage your success on the path. That's the most important factor. Because if you don't, you're going to get cynical, pessimistic, depressed, glass half empty, my glass is always half empty, what's wrong with me? That kind of feeling. And you have to actually do it every day. And during the day, otherwise, you know, it's going to be too difficult. So today I spent most of the day downloading religious art from the past. Religious art, and this was quite an interesting undertaking. I found that the reason why we aren't aware of where we are, which is in the now, which is in the timeless, locationless location, timeless, place-free place, is because we are in the sort of in the past and future mode, a past and future mode, where we're expecting to become something in the future. We're expecting to get something that we don't have right now, in the future. So we're future-oriented. We believe in a future identity. We believe that our identity will be completed in the future. And we're also in look at the past, and we feel like the past is the story of us moving toward completion. So the two looking towards the future and for instance, the millennial idea, looking toward a golden age where we'll be finally succeed and win. And then also looking at the past and seeing where we've come from, we think where we've come from. This is what prevents us from realizing that we have everything right now. We don't need any sort of completion. So I work on both the past and the future expectations. We did a great video on the millennium, the one yesterday, about this believing that of winning and the light, getting rid of the darkness. We become completely engrossed in the body. We feel that we'll then win. So we want to get rid of anything that makes us uncomfortable in the body. And so we have this tremendous belief the future is going to complete us. We're going to get what we really want. But also, there's this amazing past that we're looking at. And I did that today by going back through all this religious art and Christianity. And you realize this is, you know, it's been 2,000 years of art and culture. It's just amazing. And this is the mindset that we've been in for 2,000 years. And this is expecting something in the future. Expecting something in the future instead of realizing where we are in this timeless, placeless place of here nowness. So we keep chipping away at the past and the future, keep chipping away at it. And I chipped away a lot at the past today by seeing and downloading all of the best art in history as far as religious art goes, Judeo-Christian tradition, of all this just tremendous art. And you just, it's like, wow. So there are ways by focusing on the past, and I was looking at all this artwork from that depicted ancient times, and looking at the way that people were depicted and everything. You can feel the past, and I could feel the influence that these people had had, and how difficult it was to say to anyone at any time in history, no, now is where it's at. This is I'm not getting anything in the future. There's nothing coming to me in the future. I already know that nothing is going to be added to me. I already know that there's absolutely nothing that can ever be added to me. See, this is a great assertion to make. I already know that there's absolutely nothing that can ever be added to me, and absolutely nothing that could ever be subtracted from me. So there is a way to look at the past and feel it without being submerged. I was able to do this, and I feel like a huge weight has been taken off of me, because the culture, this world is too heavy. You know, it's too much of a load. The logic of arrogant deviation is so strong here. It seems so difficult, has been very difficult for anyone here to realize where they really are. They're not really in a world, they're in the locationless, timeless, locationless, placeless place, here nowness. This is where we all are, actually. And it's exceedingly difficult to, because of the arrogance, the logic of arrogant deviation. So I highly recommend that you realize that your spiritual path can involve this examining your value of the world, both of the future, what you think the future is going to be like, which we tackled in the last video, and really brought to light how we wait in vain for something for winning to take place. And then looking at the past, and seeing all this past like that, we've wasted our time. Nothing has ever happened, really. Nothing has really been added to us. Okay, nothing's been added to us. Nothing's been subtracted from us. It's all just been nothing at all take place here. But the whole Bible story and all those events of those ancient times, that narrative has been so potent. This has got to be, you know, one of the most potent narratives in the history of this planet, if not the most potent. And to begin to unravel this narrative and just not feel as if I am part of that narrative that has been, you know, moving in this narrative, instead realizing that there's nothing that can be added to me or subtracted from me. I'm already complete in this timeless, placeless place. So continue your work. I did something with the popes where I did a video with every single pope. Maybe I should re-release that video and just take a look at all these popes, if there's some way I could do that, because that's been a very potent narrative in our history, and somehow we need to overcome the past and the future. We need to let both the past and the future go. I'm really under a lot of pressure. I got to do it fast. So it's a combination of the logic of arrogance. It both looks to the future and believes in the past. Feels it needs to have consistency with narratives and scripts from the past, leading to an ultimate winning, where the false light of electromagnetic light, cosmic solar light, and bodies, where we become so engrossed in these that we will say that it's impossible to ever stop identifying with them, that we've permanently etched our identity with bodies, and then we think that that will win, defeat God, and we will have proved that we're the ones that are perfect, not God. And so I've been doing this tremendous Bible study the last week and a half or so, going over so much art and stories and reading the Bible and chronologies and all of this, and just trying to, you know, somehow set that down too. Everything has to be set down. Time has to be set down. And location has to be set down. See, all these locations in the Holy Land, you know, have been talked about more than any locations on this planet. Jerusalem, for instance. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. You know, it's just, and it continues to be a worldwide obsession with Jerusalem. And so I've been looking at Jerusalem, trying to lighten up this obsession. Okay. So let us look here at, I think this is a picture. Let me see what this is. Okay, so here we go. Here is a picture of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And it's so, you know, it's so romanticized, isn't it? The palm trees, the people. I mean, you can feel the drama. We've sort of concocted this drama for ourselves, actually. And this drama is in the psyche of the world in a strong way. And this looks so, it's just such a, at a higher resolution. We'll see what I can do. You know, it's not for everyone, because they can get sucked into the drama. You see, you have to be able to see it and to feel it and not get sucked into the drama of it. And full stop in the wow. So I'm able to do this now. Well, maybe before I really couldn't do that. But this is Jesus riding on a donkey, I believe. He started out in Bethany, which is on the southeast part of the Mount of Olives. and got a Bethpage, asked for a donkey to be sent to him, and then he got on the donkey, went up through Bethpage and then the Mount of Olives and down through the Garden Gethsemane, and down the trail over the Kidron Bridge, and up in through the Lion's Gate, I guess, into Jerusalem. He had triumphal entry on this, and people were out there with palm tree branches. Everyone had cut a palm tree, palm frond. And I guess they were waving, say, Hosanna, Hosanna, in the highest, you know, and praising and shouting, and some, you know, was it? They believe that this is the Messiah that is going to reestablish the kingdom of David as he went into the Jerusalem. So it was a very, 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 you know, dramatic scene, and it's been dramatized in art throughout the ages. But what we need to do is to recognize that we've put all the drama into it. That no matter how much drama the past can give us and images can give us, it's never what we really want. It's never what we really want. And we can reach realization, but we have to keep chipping away at what is it that binds us. And if we don't have realization, something is holding us. Something is holding us back. And so I keep chipping away, as I have my whole life, keep chipping away. And I keep finding more and more potent artwork. It's been quite an amazing. The Holy Spirit is progressively unfolding this to me. We had a service with our broadband supplier, where they redid the connections here and did some work, and the result was the internet suddenly speeded up a lot. It's a lot faster. I said, this is amazing. So I was able to get all this artwork downloaded, and it went real fast. You know, it was just hundreds and hundreds of paintings, and I just found these paintings today. After the internet speeded up, I came across this treasure trove of artwork. And so it's amazing how these things work. I've been progressively finding better and better resources, more and more intense resources. So this is how it goes on the path. When you work, the Holy Spirit works with you. And somehow you keep stumbling upon more and more potent intensity that you need to absorb, feel the wow of, right? And then later when you go back to it later, you'll find like, oh wow, it's just not nearly as potent. It doesn't grip me anymore. We don't want to be gripped by the past. We don't want to be gripped by the future. Okay. When the jaws of the past and the future, you know, we open up those jaws, we find we're right here, right now, in the perfection that is our freedom. And abidance is possible. This is the new dispensation, is abidance. Okay, so that's what we're going for. We're not interested in just getting glimpses. That's already happened, at least for me. That's already happened. And then when I have a glimpse, then I'm aware of what is it that's pulling me, what is it that's pulling me out of that enlightenment? What's attracting me out of it? And I'm aware of it, and then I say, okay, this, I have to go to work on this. So I saw it was this millennial fever that's going on, called the gold rush fever. It's like millennial fever. A millennial gold rush is on. But where does that come from? And now I'm seeing it comes partly from the history, Judeo-Christian history, and all of this drama and that we have imagined throughout thousands of years, pointing towards a golden age. And, you know, expecting the return of Jesus to put us into this, you know, paradise-like golden age here in the world. But really, Jesus is just here to free us from the past and the future, from time. Free us from time and place, and realize the timeless, placeless place of every awareness that is here now. And not realize that there's nothing I can get from the future. There's absolutely nothing that the future has for me. And neither does the past have anything for me. Jesus says that, that God is worshipped in spirit and truth, because God is spirit and truth, and he seeks those who worship him in spirit and truth. Very important, very important. And that's how we're doing here. We're focusing on the spiritual truth of reality, of our being, okay, instead of the perceptual drama that we have experienced in various ways. And so there are some potent veins of that pull our attention off of the now. Okay, so I tried to keep my attention on the now, coming into this world, as some of us do. I finally succumbed. I wasn't able to, and part of it was the Judeo-Christian heritage, actually, and part of it was modernism. So the two together are very potent brew, and that mixture is right now, you know, fermenting very strongly. We have this, you know, fanatic fixation on the belief in some great, wonderful technological golden future here, and also we have this tremendous hope and aspiration that Jesus is going to solve our problems somehow, and do away with those things which really bother us and irritate us, etc. And there'll be a fulfillment of all the scriptures, fulfillment of everything that we've been hoping and waiting for thousands of years. Now, I say that Jesus has already returned, already here, and we need to find out what really happens, you know, not just the drama that we have imagined and believed in. It's not necessarily, it may not be that which happens. So we need to shed ourselves of everything and be here now, be what our true identity is right now. That's the goal. That's the goal. And we're already that. And it takes a certain mindset, the mind of repentance, discipline of the full stop and the wow, to go through all this material and not get pulled into it. Don't get pulled into the drama of it. There's no drama in the self at all. There's no drama. There's no drama in our identity, in our being. No drama at all. There's no need to attain anything. Yeah, the culture, see, the culture has weighed heavily upon us, and we're trying to escape that culture by escaping into the future. But that will weigh heavily upon us, and is weighing heavily upon us. We're trying to be engrossed in secular, material, flesh, body attraction. That will weigh very, very heavily upon us. Already has. Already has, that is for sure. So I'm noticing every day there's a lot of progress in every way. So we're still very much in the go times. I'm tapping into intense and great intensity. And yet we can still feel flat. I still feel flat. Like, hey, I haven't succeeded. Where's the fruit? Where's the fruit? And this is what's difficult to keep going. It's quite difficult. And yet I encourage you to keep going. Keep going. Find something. You will find something if you're willing. You will find something to focus on. That will bring the intensity that you can handle into mind, and then just do the best you can on it, and somehow you'll be helped to succeed at this. We always want to bring intensity to our day where we're challenged. We have to challenge ourselves. So don't give up. Don't think, well, I'm flat. There's nothing I can do. I'm kind of lost momentum. No, you're probably in the shock of the wow. And just recognize that. And then use your willpower and your focus to start flipping the script of the wow. Okay? This is really, really important to succeed. Because if I look at the glass half empty, I'll think like, hey, you know what? Everything I've done in my whole life has just been a waste of time. I haven't gotten anywhere. That's how I feel. Whereas if I look at a glass half full, I say, you know, I am like super, super close here to accepting my abidance in the timeless, placeless place. I'm super, super close. And I'm it's shocking me. So I'm feeling like dull and apathetic. I think in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus was there, all the disciples, apostles, fell asleep. I mean, it was like the most important time, right? And they fell asleep. So we can feel like, oh, you know, fall asleep on the path, like on the pathless path, the path to no path. It's easy to do. And indeed, before I was taping here, I fell asleep. And I just thought, I can't tape. I'm too tired. But I got a little bit of sleepiness out, and I'm able to keep going. So you can be faced with that. So I find that it's quite helpful to go back in cultural history and free yourself up from some stuff. So this is why I'm doing this study. For example, I didn't know clearly that the evangelists, only two of them were apostles, actually. There were 12 apostles, and then there was 11 because of Judas left, and then they nominated another one. What was it, Matthias or something? I'm not sure. But they nominate another one, cast lots or something. But the evangelists are the ones that wrote the gospels that are the books that are included in the Bible, the four gospels. And Matthew was an apostle. His real name was Levi, or Levi as we call it here, Levi. Who lived? It was a publican, which is a tax collector, and lived in Capernaum, which is where Jesus basically moved to from Nazareth. And so Jesus went to Levi, his house, and called him, and or went to his place of work, wherever he saw him, he called him. And then they had that banquet in Matthew's house, where they then lowered someone through the roof, someone with palsy, and then Jesus cured them. And then there was the talk with the Pharisees in the house. Discourse happened there. Well, so Matthew was an apostle. Mark was not an apostle. He was a friend of Peter's, actually, a friend of the apostle Peter. Luke was not an apostle. Luke was a doctor. A doctor, and somehow he got a hold of some accounts of Jesus' life and wrote a narrative of it, Luke. And of course, John was an apostle. John was the brother of James, I believe. Or is that right? Or Andrew? I'm not entirely clear. Peter had a brother, maybe it was James, and then Andrew had a brother, which was John. And they were fishermen. Those four were fishermen on the Sea of Galilee, or the Sea of Tiberias, which was an important city on the west, middle of the coastline, on the west side of the Sea of Galilee, where Herod Antipas lived. And Herod Antipas was part of the Tetrarchy, which was put in power after Herod the Great died. Four rulers that they split his kingdom on the four sons, various, they took over various areas of his kingdom. And the sea is also called Lake of Gennesaret. Lake of Gennesaret, because the plain of Gennesaret is just north on the Sea of Galilee from Tiberias. And the town of Magdala is there on the southern part of the plain of Gennesaret, I believe. Gennesaret or something, no. Gennesaret. So the Sea of Gennesaret, Sea of Galilee, Sea of Tiberias. Names for the same Sea of Galilee. Magdala was where Mary Magdalene was from, that town right there. And then north of the plain of Gennesaret is Tabgha, T-A-B-G-H-A, I think. Tabgha, which is a place where Jesus went, and close to the cove of the parables is right there by Tabgha, and above the cove of parables is the mount where the Mount of Beatitudes, where the Beatitudes was given. And just about half a mile north of that is Capernaum, where Jesus spent a lot of his time in his ministry. So there's various places you see the places that are so famous, you know. Mount Moriah, what's that? That's the mountain in Jerusalem that the temple is built on. And Mount Zion, well, that's a mountain in Jerusalem, a little hill. There's a hill. These aren't mountains, these are hills. Hillocks. Yeah, hillocks there. The valley of, you know, Kidron. That's just a little ravine. It's a ravine from Jerusalem, between Jerusalem and the Mount of Olives, which is just a hill. Okay. And so you begin to locate all these names that I grew up with and heard this so many times, so much, and I didn't know what they were talking about. What they called them. Now you start seeing it and putting it in perspective and say, oh, it's just a little hillock. Just a little hill, and it's just a little cove here of pebbles and a shoreline of the water, the shore, a little hill there, the fields there. And I say, okay, you know, where's the drama? And you start realizing that we have overlaid Jesus's mission with all this drama, whereas really he was just trying to point out to us that all this is just a play of arrogance, and there is no race, there is no contest, there is no finish line, there is nothing to get, there's nothing to attain. We already are it. We already are right here, right now, as spirit and truth, the spirit of truth. We are the spirit of truth right now. So a lot of this work is to demystify, de-intensify, de-glamorize, de-dramatize. All of this, there's some noises. We don't need all that drama. We don't need it. We don't need that. We have the truth right now. And really, there's nothing in the world that has any value to us whatsoever. Never has been, never will be. There's nothing that we need to have added to us. So I'm going over the geography, the towns. I mean, the well, the Jacob's well at Sychar, which also pronounced Sychar, same place. Jacob's well, and Jesus stopped there. I believe that was where he met the Samaritan woman at the well, and told her about her life, and said that I have, you know, if you drink the water of this well, you'll still be thirsty, but if you drink the water I have for you, you will never thirst again. So this is a well on between Jerusalem and Capernaum in the land of Samaria, not Sumeria, Samaria. Sumeria, of course, is the land of the Ur, the Tigris and Euphrates River. Ur being the place where Abraham came from, which is the patriarch of the Jewish race and religion. Abraham, I believe it was Isaac and Jacob, and then Joseph went down to Egypt. Joseph, I believe. So there's you get to, you know, you just kind of you need to realize all this drama was taking place here in this land here, and you look at it and you just say, huh? Is this worth dying for? Is this worth a spiritual death for? Do I need to be spiritually dead because of this drama here in this world? Is there any drama worth being spiritually dead for, being unaware of your spirit? Other traditions, you know, have other, you know, dramas about their, you know, Buddha has a drama about his life and the places and this. And so, you know, I've been loosening up all these narratives and de-glamorizing them. And because right here, right now, we are free of any location. Okay. Right, we're free of any place, already free. Of any place. Right here, right now, we're free of any time. Right here, right now, we're free of any future. We're free of any past. We're free of any time. We're free of any place. There's nothing that we can, that is coming to us. There's nothing that can come. There's no contest. There's nothing to be won. There's no prize that can come to us. No prize that can be given unto us. We already are the allness, the one spirit of allness. We already are that. Always have been. And then you see the geography, you know, Mount Carmel and the way the mountains come down. What is that? Plain of Megiddo, the Megiddo plain that Armageddon is supposed to take place there, and you see that comes down to Mount Tabor, and then you see further up north of the Sea of Galilee, you see Mount Hermon, that range of mountains that goes into Lebanon and Syria. There you see that, and you see the geography of the area. You see Jericho, which is close to the Jordan River, between Jericho and Jerusalem. That's where the wilderness is. And you see Qumran, which is on the coast of the Dead Sea, northwest coast of the Dead Sea, right close to it, which was the Dead Sea Scrolls were found there. And this is a very deserty wilderness area between Jericho and Jerusalem. This is where Jesus went after he was baptized in the River Jordan by John the Baptist, went into that wilderness right there for 40 days and 40 nights, and was tempted, severely tempted by what? Arrogance. Call it the devil, Satan, but it's really the logic of arrogance. Was tempted by arrogance, saying, you can have this, you can have that, you know, and he said, no. And then then he went into Jerusalem, traveled from Jericho west into Jerusalem. This is a very potent narrative that's been extremely potent throughout the world for so long. And I feel you can't get... The goal is abidance in non-dual reality. And we don't want to get attracted out of it somehow, pushed, attracted out of it somehow. And one of the ways you can be pushed is if you maybe feel you're a loser, that you're a loser somehow, or that you need to be a winner in the play of this. And you don't want to... This is such a potent part of history and narrative. It's bound to be brought up as leverage in some way, to leverage you out of the now. Okay, to leverage you out of the now. So all I'm doing, the Holy Spirit's helping me become aware of all this history, and so that it cannot phase me in any way, which way. I cannot be attracted towards winning or losing. But it's a fine line. You know, you can't try to learn this stuff as try to be a winner. Okay. But you want to be aware of this so that people cannot make you feel like a loser. Like, what do you mean you're enlightened or you're a friend of Jesus? You don't even know this and this and this about his history. And then, you know, it can make you feel, oh my gosh, you know, maybe I need to know that. So it's very tricky situation, actually. Very tricky. A lot of people try to escape it by going into other religions like Buddhism and various different Hinduism, various other religions. And that necessarily, I haven't seen that being really successful for many people as far as abidance goes. And we can't escape the fact that Jesus did come here and has returned and has prepared us for this with tremendously great teaching, a teaching that is, you know, equal to anything that's ever been seen in history right now, like A Course in Miracles, for instance. A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words is equal to anything that's ever been taught anywhere. We you know, that's an inescapable fact. So I feel like I have to be able to face that whole situation, the whole history of Jesus. And people, you know, may put the pressure on me. Would say, what do you mean Jesus is back? What do you mean you say, you know, you're friends with Jesus? Well, if your friend was friends with Jesus, then you should be able to explain, you know, his history, you know, that kind of thing, which is nonsense, because we're, you know, friends in spirit and truth. Okay, which is this non-dual, you know, the goal of non-dual abidance. The realization that all bodies are just the idols of arrogance. Okay, the God of arrogance is not the true God at all. The God we've been praying to try and help us become engrossed in this world is just our own arrogance. We've just been worshiping ourselves, idolatry, narcissistic attempt to deify ourselves. You know, this is the talk. This is what Jesus knows. So I'm a friend of Jesus because I'm a friend of truth, and we can relate, you know, with the real truth instead of this drama that has been passed down for so long. That who knows how much of that is fact and how much of it is extrapolation, projection, arrogance, wishful thinking, emotionalism, dualistic, you know, logic of arrogance, this, you know, and reactions of all different, you know, it who knows exactly, but certainly people, you know, I might be, people might, I don't know, I've not gotten any pressure yet at all. But the real way to deal with it, there's some way of just saying, look, let's just focus on the now, you know, and get right back to the teaching like that. So when you're in abidance in non-dual, dual truth, you're going to be teaching. And when I was in this condition, I was imagining helping and teaching and answering questions, and I was doing very well until gradually my attention got pulled towards some sort of great battle between light and dark, and how light was like winning, and it was banishing the light and the darkness, and the darkness was disappearing and all this kind of stuff. And somehow I got pulled out of it, pulled out of being a teacher, of a non-dual teacher. So the attitudes of those in arrogance can be very full of giddy and full of hope and thinking that they're going to win and they got the answer. And if you say, no, that's not it, they can look at you and say, well, so what are you saying is it? And then they'll find some way to make you feel like a loser. Okay. And then you think, oh, I need to win. I'm a loser. I need to win. And then they point out, well, here's how you win. And they point to the future like that. So they might say, well, you're enlightened like Jesus. Well, you know, what do you know about Jesus? And you know, there's all sorts of ways that they can try to, the mind will try to push you around, rough you up. And if you think that there's some value that you don't know, maybe you're missing something really valuable of the, you know, of the past, that maybe I need to know something, and then you lose your awareness of where you really are, which is nowhere and everywhere and no place, no time at all. You lose your awareness of that, and then you feel like a loser because you lost awareness of it. So you feel like a loser, and then you feel like you need to be a winner. And then you become vulnerable to the designs of the future. So the past can be used as a way to make us feel like we're losers because we don't know everything about the past, thinking that there's something there for us. There's nothing there for us. And I say, well, Jesus was in the past. No, he was in the world, but not of it. He wasn't anywhere. He wasn't anywhere, actually. People say he was on the Mount of Olives and here in this place and this place on the road to Emmaus and all the different, you know, places that are talked about so much, and he wasn't anywhere. The reality is free of location because it has no boundary. That which has no boundary, how can you say where it is, where someone's located? The boundary-free awareness, the boundary-free presence, how can the boundary-free isness, the boundary-free pure spaciousness, how can you say there's a location? How can you claim it's a location? How can you say Jesus was actually in this location? Jesus knows he's not in any location. There's no boundaries to our identity. How can you say he was at that time, came at that time? There's no time to what is free of all boundaries. There's no time to what needs no winning or losing, no past or future. There's nothing to win. There's no contest taking place. So there is no time at all. So Jesus doesn't appear in as time, as some time say, well, I appear in this time. It's timeless. So timeless, placeless. Was in the world, but never of it. Never of it. So there's nothing that needs to be known about Jesus as far as time and place. As far as time and place. Nothing that we need to know about time and place. There is no time and place. Reality is timeless and placeless. No boundaries. Seamless. Sameness. How can we say it's time when there's the sameness? It doesn't change. So what time are we in? How do we say, how do we meaningful meaning have a meaningful talk about time when every moment is the same pure spaciousness that is unstirred, that is unfixated, that is seamless. It's ridiculous to talk about time from that perspective, isn't it? It's ridiculous to talk about location. So this is ultimately what we have to abide in, and yet the narrative of our valuing of this history, this planet, our valuing, it's very tempting to say, well, there has to be some value to it. You know, there has to be some. So I'm just looking at all this history, and gradually it's dawning upon me, you know, wow, they're really, these paintings glamorize it, but there's really no glamour to it at all. If we can look at it like that, it was absolutely not a shred of glamour to anything that's ever taken place here. And no real drama either. There's no drama in reality. There's nothing up for contest. Nothing is being contested. There's no contest. God is not involved in any contest with us. There's nothing that is up for to be contested at all. There's no drama. There's no glamour. Interesting. Very interesting. Haven't had any work for 2 days, nothing. So I've just kept working on the pathless path to no path. How can there be a path when there's no time or location? How can we arrive somewhere when reality's placeless and timeless? So history assumes some sort of path, you see. The path of history. So there's all these paths in the Bible. There's a path from Capernaum around the Sea of Galilee. There's these trails all the way along the Sea of Galilee. You can circumnavigate it 33 miles. From Capernaum to Bethsaida. Go along the north of Sea of Galilee, going east to Bethsaida. There's a path there, from Capernaum down to Tabitha, down to plain of Gennesaret, down to Magdala, down to Tiberias. And there's paths that you can walk along, from Nazareth to Capernaum. There's all sorts of paths through the what they call the Holy Land. And you look at it and you just, you know, it's like very rocky and stony there. Very rocky and stony, and stones everywhere. And there's just all these little hills and valleys, hills and dales, as we call it. Hills and dales. Kind of gentle ravines and escarpments and rocks and old, worn. And you wind your way along these trails with stone walls and pebbles along stone pathways. And it's kind of barren and dry, and you just say, ah, is that really worth valuing and dying for? Dying a spiritual death of a spiritual unawareness of where I am right now? That I am timeless and placeless? Is it worth giving up the realization that I'm timeless and placeless to think that I'm walking along some stony path somewhere? In the Holy Land, I'm walking down towards Jerusalem, walking along the Jordan Valley, along the Jordan River. There's a pathway there. So there's some water, there's some trees, and it's hot, it's dusty, it's rocky, and sweating and hungry. Kind of hungry. feet are aching. With some other people feel the same way. Gotta go to the bathroom. Got a long ways to go, journey, you know, so might kind of worried about what the future might hold, and just kind of trying to survive, and yeah, that's what it was like. My clothes are wearing out, my sandals are wearing out. Hard to make a living, hard to survive. Gets cold at night. Feel kind of alienated and a little bit frightened. Look up at the stars, say, where the heck am I here? What is this world? You hear news, everyone you meet has news to give you, and it's kind of odd news, bizarre stuff's happening. John the Baptist just got thrown in prison. Everybody's a little bit giddy about all these baptizing that's going along, and yet then John the Baptist just was executed, and people go back to their homes. They have to plow these rocky fields. You know, the rain comes, the seasons come, get cold, you're struggling along, taking care of the animals, all the chores, you know, you getting dirt in your fingernails, getting blisters. You know, it's just the same life. It's the same life that's always been going on here. Paintings tend to dramatize things. That's the purpose of painting, is to put all this emotion and drama and action, kind of try to capture the whole situation there. But really, it's just been the same as same old, always. The body is the chosen idol of arrogance. And death is the covenant that arrogance believes it's made with God to maintain the contest, to show goodwill in this imaginary contest that are dreaming that there's a contest with God and that we have to win it or we'll be annihilated. So we all have these beliefs and all these covenants and laws and restrictions and regulations and rituals and all this stuff. We have to do all this stuff thinking that God is going to smite us. We're worried about our mortality, getting sick, what happens when we die. This has been going on from the very, very beginning of identifying with bodies. All sorts of plagues and pestilence, and you know, mosquitoes are biting us, and fleas and ticks, and you know, all sorts of nasty stuff is insects and getting into our food, and yeah, it's just life is as usual. Now, we hope we're going to escape all that, and yet you find out then that you start having all sorts of mental illnesses, mental problems, all sorts of, your behavior becomes a bit bizarre, actually, and you feel like some sort of vague alienation, some vague disassociation. Start taking drugs to try and feel better, you just get sick. Take pharmaceuticals. You know, you're aging. Your life's slipping away. Same old, same old. Same old, same old. Okay, what? You know, that's not very glamorous, is it? So we're expecting all this stuff to happen, bodies to be raising out of graves, spirits to be flying all over the place. You know, just as they expected that back then, they thought this, you know, life's going to get real interesting. We're going to be lifted out of this hellhole here. real soon. I mean, that's what the apostles believed. Now, St. Paul wasn't an original apostle, but he called himself an apostle. He claimed that he was because of his work and conversion and all that, and experience with Jesus on the road to Damascus. So he insisted he was an apostle, Apostle Paul. And he was a Pharisee who believes in a resurrection of the dead, that all the dead will come out of their graves and start floating around. They even said that happened in Jerusalem. All the dead were floating around in Jerusalem. And he expected that Jesus was going to come back before he died in his generation, and he would be raptured up into heaven. And that's what they believed. Well, you know, that this is a way of certainly making your life seem really more interesting than it really is. That's not to say that something eventually might happen in terms of that helping us out, in terms of helping us out with our arrogance and avoiding the pit of arrogance that is the world right now, that we're going into such a severe pit. It's possible that something could happen. But I don't sit around waiting for it. I keep applying myself to, you know, enlightenment, non-dual abidance. Whatever happens, we still have to reach that goal. Still have to reach that goal. So just keep working on that goal, and then if there's something happens, okay, just fine, that's great. We certainly don't want to go forward in the world of artificial intelligence with that. This isn't something that I feel comfortable with at all. So I basically said no to that part of the dream. Just say no, enough's enough. I've had enough of existence. So time to wake up and realize where I am, which is nowhere. So we need to keep reinforcing this, because initially when we say, well, I'm nowhere, we say, oh my God, that's terrible. You know, we just automatically assume that's a terrible thing, to be nowhere. Maybe it's a wonderful feeling. No boundaries. And if we can get back that feeling, that being nowhere, timelessly nowhere, is a wonderful feeling. This is our natural feeling. If we can get that back, that's what we need to get back. So I continue to encourage everyone to work as much as you can every day, and whatever happens will happen. We keep working, we'll be better prepared for it. So keep focusing on that. I am nowhere. I'm absolutely nowhere. I'm timelessly nowhere. And since there is nowhere for me to be, I don't need any time to get there. I don't need any time to get to where I am, because I'm nowhere. And how can that which is nowhere be a thing or a body? How can that which is nowhere be a thing or a body? Right? I am nowhere. I am nothing. I am nowhere. I am timelessly nowhere. Yes, I already know that I am nowhere. Yes, I already know that I am nowhere. So, remember the glass half full. Glass is half full. You're in the wow. We're in the wow. You're in this wow. Continually, you're feeling that there's always a subcurrent of wow. Sometimes it becomes very intense, very acute. And so we have to recognize this and just full stop in the wow. Stay calm, full stop in the wow. you may be working on something that's more intense than you realize. And so you have to realize your glass is half full. Absolutely, it's half full. So, I am nowhere. I am nowhere. So I can't be a thing, can I? And I can't, and time is meaningless. There's nowhere for me to go. I'm nowhere. I am that which is nowhere. I am that which is nowhere. And we can get start having a positive feeling towards that. I'm edging towards that. I can feel it bit by bit by bit. Little glimpses. Like little remembrances, little glimpses. Oh, yeah. Okay. All right. Very great. We'll continue on. I'm just, again, these are videos of encouragement. Encouragement. We need to stay encouraged. We need to be reminded our glass is half full. And if you start feeling down, immediately realize, hey, full stop in the wow. I'm in the wow. I'm feeling this reaction of my success has been so tremendous. I'm feeling, wow, kind of flat. Re-identify where you're at. Feeling flat because of the wow. It's not really, it's this flatness of kind of shock. Accept it, realize it, and say, okay, I'm going to work on this. Start working on it. You'll start getting some momentum going. You'll start flipping the script, and you'll then feel some intensity coming back, and you realize, hey, I really am very far along. Okay, this is how you keep the ball rolling. Keep the ball rolling. It's super important to keep the ball rolling right now. So that's why we keep making these videos, to keep the ball rolling. If you let it stop, it's hard to get rolling again. How do you get the ball rolling? Reminding yourself it hasn't stopped. You're just in the wow mode. You still have the momentum. The ball is still rolling, actually. It's just that you're like catching your breath and you're hardly aware of it.